طيب، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا يا رب العالمين، واجعلنا هداة مهتدين غير ضالين ولا مضلين برحمتك يا رحمن الرحيم. جزاكم الله خير for joining. And we ask Allah تبارك وتعالى to make this a blessed gathering. We ask Allah تبارك وتعالى to make us from those who hear the speech and follow the best of it. And we ask Allah تبارك وتعالى to benefit us with what we hear. نعم. We're going to carry on إن شاء الله تعالى book تبيان في آداب حملة القرآن, which we stopped at الباب السابع. We are at the seventh chapter. And in this chapter, we're talking about the آداب في آداب الناس كلهم مع القرآن. The etiquette and the character of the people, the etiquette that all the people they should have with the Quran. This is what this is about. So all the general etiquette, previously we spoke about etiquette of the people. Right, the people of the Quran, the carriers of the Quran, the ones who memorize the Quran, the teacher of the Quran, the student of the Quran. Now, specifically, generally, now all the Muslims as a whole that they should have with the Quran, and all of mankind as a whole, the etiquette that they should have with the Quran. He says, "Rahimahullah azza wa jalla, thabbata fi sahih Muslim, rahimahullah taala, an Tamim al-Dari radiyallahu anhu qal, inna Nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qal, ad-dinu an-nasiha, qulna liman? قال لله ولكتابه ولرسوله ولأئمة المسلمين وعامتهم." He said that it has been reported in Sahih Muslim from the Sahabi al-Jalil Tamim al-Dari radiyallahu anhu arda. He said the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said الدين نصيحة, and it means الدين, the religion, it is النصيحة. النصيحة, it means sincerity, to be sincere and to be pure and to have good intent in what you are doing, and you do and you fill all the obligations you require in the deen, or that you're obliged to do in the deen. And the Sahaba said, "Qulna liman?" Who's it for, ya Rab, oh Messenger of Allah? Who should be sincere to? Who should be sincere for? What should be sincere for? So he's responded by saying, "Lillahi," for Allah, "wali kitabihi," and his book, the Quran, "wali rasulihi," and his messenger, "wali aimmatil muslimin," and the leaders of the Muslims and the scholars, "wa ammatihim," and the laymen, the general folk. Now all these different, observe the rights of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and to observe the rights of the Quran, this book of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and to observe the rights of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and also the leaders of the Muslims and scholars, and also the general layman of the Muslims, to observe all their rights. قال العلماء رحمه الله تعالى النصيحة لكتاب الله تعالى هي الإيمان بأنه كلام الله تعالى وتنزيله. The ulama rahimahum Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, they said النصيحة, to be one who has nasiha, who is sincere, who is pure, who has pure intentions when it comes to the book of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, it is number one to have iman in the Quran, to believe in the Quran. So the first thing in terms of nasiha for the Quran, the book of Allah azza wa jal, it is to have iman that it is kalamullah, the speech of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, wa tanziluhu, and that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala revealed it. So it's a speech of Allah, it is not created, it's an attribute of Allah, and Allah azza wa jal revealed it. لا يشبه شيء من كلام الخلق. Nothing is like it from the speech of the creation. ولا يقدر على مثله الخلق بأسرهم. And no one amongst the creation is ever to create or produce anything like it. Every single one of them, all of the creation, jinn kind of mankind, as Allah Azza wa Jalla says, قل إن اجتمعت الإنس والجن على أن يأتوا بمثل هذا القرآن لا يأتون بمثله ولو كان بعضهم لبعض ظهيرا. Say to Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام, if all of mankind and jinn came together to produce anything like this Quran, they will not be able to produce it if all of them aided and assisted each other. ثم تعظيمه وتلاوته حق تلاوته. And then after that, the next right, it is that you تعظيم, you glorify the Quran. You glorify the Quran. The Quran has a great place in your heart, and you venerate it. وَتِلَاوَتُهُ, and that you recite it. And tilawa also means following it. حَقَّ تِلَاوَتِهِ, as it deserves to be recited and as it deserves to be followed. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran, الَّذِينَ آتَيْنَاهُمُ الْكِتَابِ يَتُلُونَهُ حَقَّ تِلَاوَتِهِ أُولَٰئِكَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ. Those that we have granted the scripture, the Quran, يَتُلُونَهُ, they recite it. Okay, حق تلاوته, as it deserves to be recited. But يتلونه also means يتبعونه, they follow it as it deserves to be followed. أولئك يؤمنون به, they are the true believers in the scripture. وتحسينها والخشوع عندها, and to beautify your recitation and to have خشوع when you're reciting as well. وإقامة حروفه في التلاوة, and to observe the letters of the Quran, to pronounce them correctly with the مخارج, to articulate them from the right articulation points, and to give them the right attributes and characteristics that it deserves. والذب عنه لتأويل المحرفين, and to protect it, and to protect the Quran from ta'wil al-muharrifin, from the ta'wil of the muharrifin, those who the interpretation of those who try to distort the Quran. You defend the Quran from that. وَتَعَرُّضُ الطَّاغِينَ, and also those who are transgressive and oppressive, what they try to say about the Quran, you defend the Quran from it. وَالتَصْدِيقُ بِمَا فِيهِ, and to believe in everything that is in the Quran. وَالْوُقُوفُ مَعَ أَحْكَامِهِ, and to also وقوف, that you stop and you do and you follow his ahkam, يعني the warnings of the Quran, you act upon them. وَتَفَهُمُ عُلُومِهِ وَأَمْثَالِهِ, and to understand and comprehend the sciences in the Quran and the parables that are given, the examples that are given in the Quran. وَالْاَعْتِبَارُ بِمَوَاعِظِهِ, and to take lessons from the ayat and the mawa'id, the admonishments that are in the Quran. وَالْتَفَكُّرُ فِي عَجَائِبِهِ, and to reflect upon the wonders of the Quran. وَالْعَمَلُ بِمُحْكَمِهِ, and to act upon the clear-cut, unambiguous ayat of the Quran, the clear verses of the Quran, that you act upon them. وَالْتَسْلِيمُ بِمُتَشَابِهِ, and that you submit to the ambiguous verses, you do not try to distort their meaning or interpret it in a way that is not intended by it, but you submit to it and you surrender to it, and you do not try to distort the meaning of that ambiguous ayat, rather you refer them back to the unambiguous ayat, and that's how you understand it correctly. For instance, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he says, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَا حَفِظُونَ, verily we have revealed the Quran, and verily we shall protect it. Now this we, one may say this is ambiguous. This, he may understand it as Allah is more than one. Allah is three or one, more than one God, when Allah says we. But we refer back to the muhkam, the unambiguous verses. Allah says, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ, say Allah Azza is one. So that shows us now this we is the royal we. It shows that Allah is great, is not more than one, it's referring to royal we. وَالْبَحْثُ عَنْ عُمُومِهِ وَخُصُوصِهِ, and to look out for the different sides in the Quran, and the general ayats that have general meanings, and the ones that have specific meanings, وَالنَّاسِخِهِ وَمَنْسُوقِهِ, and the abrogated verses, and what abrogated it. وَنَشْرُ عُلُومِهِ, and to spread the science of the Qur'an. وَالدُّعَاءُ إِلَيْهِ, and to call to the Qur'an, to call people to learn the Qur'an, to act upon the Qur'an, to study the Qur'an, to live by the Qur'an. وَإِلَى مَا ذَكَرْنَا مِنْ نَصِيحَتِهِ, and also all of that we have mentioned is from the nasiha for the Qur'an. And no doubt everyone does it according to their ability. Everyone does it according to their ability where they're at. But all these matters that Imam Nawawi just mentioned, it is from the nasiha of the Qur'an, to have nasiha, to be one who's sincere and fulfills the rights of the Book of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Fasl, the next section. Fi wujubi ta'zim al-Quran. This section is about the obligation of venerating and glorifying the Quran. He says, Rahimahullah Azza wa Jal, ajma' al-Muslimun ala wujubi ta'zim al-Quran al-Azizi ala al-Itlaq. He says that the Muslims, they are in consensus that it is obligatory to venerate the Quran, وَتَنْزِيهِهِ وَصِيَانَتِهِ, and to protect it. وَأَجْمَعُوا عَلَىٰ أَنَّ مَنْ جَحَدَ مِنْهُ حَرْفًا مِمَّا أُجْمِعَ عَلَيْهِ أَوْ زَادَ حَرْفًا مِمَّا لَمْ يَقْرَأُ بِهِ أَحَدٌ وَهُوَ عَالِمٌ بِذَلِكَ فَهُوَ كَافِرٌ. And they are also in consensus, whoever denies a letter from the Qur'an that is agreed upon that this is Qur'an, part of the Qur'an, or he increases a letter that's not part of the Qur'an, he adds it to the Qur'an, and he does it intentionally whilst he knows that this is wrong, or he knows that this is not part of the Qur'an, whoever does that upon knowledge, فَهُوَ كَافِرٍ, he's a disbeliever. He has distorted the Qur'an, he is a disbeliever. There's a consensus in that. قال الإمام الحافظ أبو الفضل القاضي عياض رحمه الله تعالى, القاضي عياض رحمه الله, he says, اعلم أن من استخف بالقرآن, he knows, no, the one who ridicules the Qur'an and belittles the Qur'an and does not respect the Qur'an, أو بالمصحف, or the Mus'haf, أو بشيء منه, or something that's part of the Qur'an or the Mus'haf, أو سبهما, or who insults them both, أو جحد حرف منه, or he denies a letter amongst the Qur'an, he denies that it's part of the Qur'an, أو كذب بشيء مما صرح به فيه من حكم أو خبر, or he denies a part of it that has been made clear that is part of it, which is either a ruling or information that the Quran has given us news. أو أثبت ما نفاه, or he affirms something the Quran has negated. أو نفى ما أثبته هو عالم بذلك, or he negates something the Quran has affirmed, and he knows this, he does it upon knowledge, he's not ignorant, he doesn't do it out of ignorance, he knows. عالم, أو شك في شيء من ذلك. Or he doubts something amongst these matters. فهو كافر بإجماع المسلمين. He's a kafir with a consensus of the Muslims. There's no differing on that. He's that person will disbelieve. So what do we take from that? If you disrespect the Quran, you insult the Quran, you deny something that's amongst the Quran, you affirm something that's not in the Quran, you negate something that is in the Quran, etc. All of these matters, you do it, or you doubt something that's in the Quran, you say, I don't think it's in the Quran, or you doubt it, etc. One of these matters that we mentioned previously, you doubt it, then the person will become a kafir if he's alim of that. He does it upon knowledge. He's not ignorant. An ignorant one may be excused to a certain extent. وكذلك إن جحد التوراة والإنجيل. And like that, if he denies the Torah and Injil أو كتب الله تعالى المنزلة, or he disbelieves in the Torah and the Injil, or any of the other books that Allah Azza has revealed, أو كفر بهما, or he disbelieves in them, أو سبها, or he insults them, these books, أو استخف بها, or he mocks them and ridicules them, فهو كافر, he's also a disbeliever, because it's part of our iman that we believe in all the books that have been revealed from Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. It doesn't mean that we follow the Torah and Injil, we only follow the Quran, because the Quran has abrogated them. However, and the Torah and Injil that are present now, they have been distorted. But we're talking about the original Torah and Injil that Allah has revealed, the one who insults them, or he ridicules them, or he mocks them, etc. And that person would have disbelieved as well. قال وقد أجمع المسلمون على أن القرآن المتلو في جميع الأقطار المكتوب في المصحف الذي بأيدي المسلمين مما جمعه الدفتان من أول الحمد لله رب العالمين إلى آخر قل أعوذ برب الناس كلام الله تعالى ووحيه المنزل على نبيه محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. He says and they also have the Muslims are in consensus of the Quran that we recite in every part of the world. المكتوب that is written in the Mushaf الذي بأيدي المسلمين, that's in the hands of the Muslims. مما جمعه الدفتين, that has been gathered between the two covers of the Mushaf. من أول الحمد لله رب العالمين, from the beginning of Surah Al-Fatiha إلى آخر, to the end of قول أعوذ برب الناس, Surah Al-Nas, that it is كلام الله تعالى, the speech of Allah عز وجل, ووحيه المنزل, and the revelation of Allah عز وجل has been revealed على نبيه, upon his prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, وأن جميع ما فيه حق, and everything that is in it is true. وأن من نقص منه حرفا قاصدا لذلك, and whoever decreases a letter from it intentionally, أو بدله بحرف آخر, or he changes it with another letter, مكانه, and he puts it in another letter in his place, أو زاد فيه حرفا, or he adds a letter to it, مما لم يشتمل عليه المصحف الذي وقع عليه الإجماع, which is not part of the mushaf that the ulama and the Muslimin have agreed upon in consensus, وَأُجْمِعَ عَلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَيْسَ بِقُرْآنِ, and there's a consensus that this letter that you have added to the Qur'an that is not part of the Qur'an, عَامِدًا لِكُلِّ هَذَا, and the person who does all of this, he adds a letter, decrease a letter, he does it all intentionally, فَهُوَ كَافِرٌ, the person is a kafir, he's a disbeliever. You fall into disbelief by doing that. قال أبو عثمان بن الحداد, he says, جميع من ينتحل التوحيد متفقون على أن الجحد بحرف من القرآن كفر. He said, every single individual who believes in Tawheed, who is a follower of Tawheed, whose creed is the Tawheed of Allah عز وجل, and the Muslims, they are in consensus, in agreement, that the one who denies and disbelieves in a letter of the Quran, he's a kafir. That's a disbelief.
وقد اتفق فقهاء بغداد على استتابة ابن شنبوذ المقرئ أحد أئمة المقرئين المتصدرين بها مع ابن مجاهد لقراءته وإقرائه بالشواذ من الحروف مما ليس في المصحف. وعقدوا عليه للرجوع عنه والتوبة منه سجلا أشهد فيه على نفسه في مجلس الوزير أبي علي ابن مقلة سنة 23 و300. And he says, he mentions here an incident that occurred. The fuqaha, the scholars of Baghdad in Iraq, they were all in agreement that a man who's known as Ibn Shambuz was a man who used to recite with the Qira'at al-Shadda. And the Qira'at al-Shadda are basically a Qira'at which contradicts the Mus'haf. Okay, it has something in it that's not part of what's in the Mus'haf that we have here. So it's not considered the Quran and not allowed to recite that as Quran or teach it as Quran. So he used to recite it and teach it as Quran and say, oh, this is Quran, when in reality it's not Quran. And he used to do that. So they were all in agreement to this man, Ibn Shambuth, that yustatab, he is to be requested to repent from this sin, from what he's doing. Because they believe that if he's asked to repent, if he does not repent, then what will happen? He's a kafir. His blood will become halal. Understand? Because he's distorted the speech of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And this is obviously done in an Islamic state. It's not something that an individual does by himself. This was done by the judge of that state, etc., who would go through the necessary stages in order to verify this and make sure this is right. وأفتى أبو محمد بن أبي زيد فيما ابن أبي زيد فيما قال لصبي لعن الله معلمك وما علمك وقال أردت سوء الأدب ولم أريد القرآن قال يؤدب القائل قال وأما من لعن المصحف فإنه يقتل. One of the scholars named Abu Muhammad ibn Abi Zayd, he gave a fatwa regarding the one who says to a child who is a student of the Quran. Okay, he says to him, لعن الله معلمك وما علمك. He says, may Allah curse your teacher and وما علمك, and what he taught you. He says that the individual who said this, he said, أردتُ سوء الأدب. I intended by this, his bad manners, not the Quran. Right? He said, in response to this, his fatwa was the Qadi, the Sheikh, he said in response to this, he said, يؤدب القائل, the one who intended by it, يعني, bad manners, because it can be understood, he meant the Quran. He said, يؤدب القائل, the one who said this, he's disciplined, يعني, he's disciplined by the Islamic courts. قال, وأما من لعن المصحف, and the one who curses the Mus'haf, the Quran itself, فإنه يقتل, that one is to be executed because he's a kafir. هذا آخر كلام القاضي عياض رحمه الله عز وجل. And this is all of what Imam القاضي عياض رحمه الله عز وجل, he mentions regarding this. He mentioned all these different statements. And that's the end of that section. فصل في حكم تفسير القرآن. This section is about the ruling of تفسير القرآن, the تفسير of the Quran. What's the ruling regarding doing the تفسير of the Quran? Explain the meaning of the Quran. He says, ويحرم تفسيره بغير علم. He says, and it's haram to explain the Quran without knowledge. وَالْكَلَامُ فِي مَعَانِيهِ لِمَنْ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا. And it's also haram to talk about the meanings of the Quran whilst you're not qualified to do so. وَالْأَحَادِيثُ فِي ذَلِكَ كَثِيرًا. And the ahadith regarding this are a lot. وَالْإِجْمَاءُ مُنْعَقَدٌ عَلَيْهِ. And there's a consensus amongst the scholars of Islam and the Muslims generally that to one who does not know the Quran and does not know the meaning of the Quran is not qualified, it's haram for him to speak back the meaning of the Quran. وَأَمَّا تَفْسِيرُهُ لِلْعُلَمَاءِ. And as for the tafsir of the Quran for the scholars of Islam, فَجَائِزٌ حَسَنٌ. It's permissible and is recommended. وَالْإِجْمَاعُ مُنْعَقِدٌ عَلَى ذَلِكَ. And there's a consensus amongst the Muslims regarding that. فَمَنْ كَانَ أَهْلًا لِلْتَفْسِيرِ. So whoever's qualified for tafsir, جَامِعًا لِلْأَدَوَاتِ الَّتِي يُعْرَفُ بِهَا مَعْنَاهُ. And he has all the tools he requires in order to derive the right meanings from the Quran. وَغَلَبَ عَلَى ظَنِّهِ الْمُرَادِ. فسره إن كان مما يدرك بالاجتهاد يدرك بالاجتهاد. And he is someone who has the right tools and he's also able to understand the meaning of what's intended by the verses. فسره, he should explain the ayat. إن كان مما, if it's something that's مما يدرك بالاجتهاد, something that can be understood with اجتهاد, اجتهاد العلماء. كالمعاني, like the meaning. والأحكام الخفية والجلية, and like the rulings that are in the Quran that are hidden and also the rulings that are clear. والعموم الخصوص, and the verses that are general, to differentiate them from the verses that are خاص, that are specific. والإعراب, and also the grammar of the Quran. وغير ذلك, and other than that. وإن كان يما لا يدرك بالاجتهاد, and if it's from the matters that you cannot يعني understand with اجتهاد, كالأمور التي طريقها النقل, like the matters that are all through transmission. You have to have the transmitted from others the meaning, okay? وتفسير الألفاظ اللغوية, and also the, يعني, interpreting the meaning, the linguistic meaning of the words in Arabic. فلا يجوز الكلام فيها إلا بنقل صحيح من جهة المعتمدين من أهله. So you're not allowed to talk about the linguistic side and also the transmission side, meaning the ahadith and the statements of the sahaba and the salaf and all this stuff that's to do with this, that you have to transmit. You're not allowed to talk about it except by transmitting it correctly. من جهات المعتمدين من أهله, from those who are trustworthy and they're reliable sources, from the qualified people in those fields that you're in, either in the Arabic language, the scholars of the Arabic language, or the scholars in the other fields of hadith and so on. وأما من كان ليس من أهله, and as for the one who is not from the people who are qualified, لكونه غير جامع لأدواته, because he perhaps doesn't have the tools in order to understand the Quran, فحرام عليه التفسير, so it's haram for him to do tafsir. لكن له أن ينقل التفسير عن المعتمدين من أهله, but he's allowed to transmit the tafsir. He can read a book of tafsir and read it for others and explain that. He's allowed to do that, but he can't make his own tafsir of the Quran, open the mushaf, the Quran, and he starts interpreting the ayat as he wishes, if he doesn't have the tools to do so. But he's allowed, if he doesn't have the tools, to read a book of tafsir and explain that book of tafsir to others. ثم المفسرون برأيهم من غير دليل صحيح أقسام. He's an as for the مفسرون, those who interpret and explain the Quran, برأيهم with their opinions, من غير دليل, without any evidence, any authentic evidence. They are different types, he says. The first type, منهم من يحتج بآية على تصحيح مذهبه وتقوية خاطره مع أنه لا يغلب على ظنه أن ذلك هو المراد بالآية وإنما يقصد الظهور على خصمه. He says that the first type of people who explain the Quran with their opinions, the first group, it is those who explain the ayah, okay, based on a school of thought. And they're not really convinced that this is actually the correct meaning of the ayah, but because they want to support their school of thought, they take that opinion and they follow it and they push that. Okay? And that's the first one. He says, وَمِنْهُمْ. And the second type, it is, من يقصد الدعاء إلى خير ويحتج بآية غير أن تظهر له دلالة لما قاله. And he says the second type, it is those who intend to call people to خير. They intend to call people to goodness. Okay? ويحتج بآية من غيري. And he uses an ayah of the Quran and he interprets it in a certain way to back up his point. But he doesn't really find out the correct meaning of the ayah. So he uses the ayah, it looks like it supports his point, and he uses it to support his point. That's the second type. And then he says a third type. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يُفَسِّرُ أَلْفَاظَهُ الْعَرَبِيَّةِ مِنْ غَيْرِ وَقُوفٍ عَلَى مَعَانِيهَا عِنْدَ أَهْلِهَا. He says, it is those, the third type are those who explain the Arabic terms and Arabic words in the Quran without referring back to the experts in the Arabic language and going back to the dictionaries and so on. وَهِيَ مِمَّا لَا يُؤْخَذُ إِلَّا بِالسَّمَعِ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْعَرَبِيَةِ وَأَهْلِ التَّفْسِيرِ. And some of these words are only learned through hearing it from the people of the Arabic language, the scholars of the Arabic language, or the scholars of the tafsir. كَبَيَانِ مَعْنَى اللَّفْظَ وَعِرَابِهَا, which is like explaining the meaning of a word and also the Arab of it, the grammatical analysis of the word as well. It is taken from a scholar, an expert in Arabic language. وَمَا فِيهَا مِنَ الْحَذْفِ وَالْإِخْتِصَارِ وَالْإِضْمَارِ, and also some of the techniques that are used in the words, like al-hadh, sometimes something may be erased, but only the expert in the Arabic language will know that this word missing here has been erased, but it's implied, for instance. Or al-ikhtisar, it's been summarized. Or al-idmar, it's implied, etc. وَالْحَقِيقَةُ وَالْمَجَازِ, and literal, the literal words, and the words that are illiteral, that are figurative, or they're metaphorical, etc. وَالْعُمُومِ الْخُصُوصِ, and also if you understand the terms that indicate something is general, and you understand the terms that indicate something is specific. وَالْإِجْمَالُ وَالْبَيَانِ, and also when something is mentioned in detail, was mentioned without a lot of detail. وَالْتَقْدِيمُ وَالْتَأْخِيرُ, when something is being placed, يعني, something is being preceded, it's mentioned before something else, etc. And so on. وَغَيْرِ ذَلِكِ مَّهُ خَلَافُ الظَّاهِرِ, and all these matters that are opposite to what's apparent. It's not the apparent, right? It's not following the apparent method. ولا يكفي في ذلك معرفة العربية وحدها. It is not sufficient to know Arabic only to figure these things out. بل لابد معها من معرفة ما قاله على التفسير فيها. But also you need to know what the people of tafsir, the scholars of tafsir have said about these matters as well. فقد يكونون مجتمعين على ترك الظاهر. Because sometimes the scholars of tafsir, they could be in agreement that they do not follow the apparent meaning and they follow another meaning. وكما إن كان اللفظ مشتركا بين معاني. And sometimes a word, it can have numerous meanings. So they choose a meaning that is not the one of the meanings that you have perhaps chosen. فعلم في موضع أن المراد إحدى المعاني. And in one ayah or one place, it can mean a word can mean a certain thing. And in another verse, it can mean something else because of the context, etc. ثم فسر كل ما جاء به فهذا كله تفسير بالرأي وهو حرام والله تعالى عالم. And all of these matters that we mentioned, that the person just makes tafsir with opinions, all that is haram. Not allowed. It's haram. You're not allowed to do that. Just to do tafsir with the only opinions. You just make things up, right? Without knowing all these things. All of that is haram. It is a major sin. Not allowed. Now, طيب. So the conclusion of that, it is in order to do tafsir of the Quran, first of all, you need to be a scholar. And you need to have the right tools in order to do tafsir. Okay, if you don't have enough tools, you are allowed to transmit a tafsir from one of the scholars who is qualified in tafsir. Okay, but you're never allowed to do tafsir with your own opinion, right? Now, طيب فصل in the next section في حرمة المراء والجدال في القرآن. This section is about that is haram to argue regarding the Quran or in the Quran. يعني to argue about something that's in the Quran without any evidence is haram. يعني. Without any right. He says, يحرم المراء في القرآن والجدال فيه بغير حق. It's haram to debate and to argue regarding something that's in the Quran without any right. ومن ذلك انتظر له دلالة الآية على شيء يخالف مذهبه. For instance, that he finds something in the Quran that a verse, it indicates something that is contrary to what his school of thought it is. ويحتمل احتمالا ضعيفا موافق موافقة مذهبه, and it also holds a very weak meaning that may support his school of thought, but the overall meaning, the stronger meaning, it supports contrary to his school of thought. فيحمله على مذهبه, but he follows the weak side, he doesn't follow the overwhelming obvious side. ويناظر على ذلك مع ظهورها له في خلاف ما يقول, and then he debates, argues regarding that. And just for the sake of it, just support his stance and his position of his madhab. That's not allowed. That's haram. وأما من لا يظهر له ذلك فهو معذور. As for the one who can't see that, and he can't see that the other side, etc., he hasn't found the evidence indicating that, then he's معذور. He's excused. وقد صح عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, and it's been reported in the authentic hadith of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام that he said, المراء في القرآن كفر. The one who debates in the Quran, it is kufrun, it is disbelief, meaning he debates. Okay, and this, what is meant by this? قال الخطابي, الخطابي قيل المراد بالمراء الشك. Now he said the meaning of debating here, it is not just arguing but doubting, it is الشك. And this is what the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام was saying, that يعني debating, he means by it doubting the Quran, that is disbelief. وقيل الجدال المشكك فيه, and also al-jidal, it said that it is the one who is making others doubt the Quran. وَقِيلَ هُوَ الْجِدَالُ الَّذِي يَفْعَلُهُ أَهْلُ الْأَهْوَى فِي آيَاتِ الْقَدْرِ وَنَحْوِهَا. And it's also said the meaning of it, this hadith, it is debating and arguing that the people of desires they do regarding the ayat of qadr, the verses that are to do the predestined decree of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, things that are like it, that are to do the unseen, they debate regarding that, and that's and negating your iman, so you fall into kufr by doing that. Now, next section now. فصل في أدب السؤال عن الأمور التوقيفية في القرآن. Now this is regarding the etiquette of asking about the matters that are توقيفية في القرآن. Matters that are توقيفية. What does that mean? That these matters, توقيفية means that these matters cannot be done except with evidence from the Quran or Sunnah. Almost, that's what توقيفي means, right? What is the etiquette of asking about these matters without being rude or without being someone who has transgressed their limits? That's what he's going to talk about now. He says, وَيَنْبَغِي لِمِنْ أَرَادَ سُؤَالَ عَنْ تَقْدِيمِ آيَةٍ. He says, and it's befitting for the one who wants to ask regarding تَقْدِيمِ آيَةٍ عَلَى آيَةٍ فِي الْمُصْحَفِ. And he wants to ask about something as tawqifi. For instance, the order of the ayat. This ayah has been placed before this ayah. Right? He wants to know the reason for that, right? أو مناسبة هذه الآية. Or he wants to ask about, يعني, what's what is the link between these verses? Okay, what is the reason why they're linked, why they're mentioned together, etc. He wants to know the reason behind that. Okay. يقول, he should say, ما الحكمة في كذا? What is the wisdom behind it? The etiquette asking about this is, you shouldn't say why. It's wrong to say why. You say, ما الحكمة في كذا? What is the wisdom behind this? That's how you should ask it. Because everything Allah does, because the ayat, the way the order of the ayat is tawqif is from Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah commanded the Prophet to place the ayah here, and the order of the ayat here, and this ayah, etc. So if you want to know, instead of you asking why, that's you questioning Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. That's haram, that's allowed. Rather you say, what's the wisdom behind that? That's the etiquette. ما الحكمة في كذا? What's the wisdom behind this? And what's the wisdom behind that? And so on. نعم. Okay, we're going to conclude with this next section, inshallah ta'ala. فصل في كراهة قولي نسيت آية كذا. This section is about that it is disliked to say, I have forgotten a certain verse. I have forgotten. Just like to say, I have forgotten. طيب, this is ويكره أن يقول, it's disliked to say, نسيت آية كذا, I have forgotten that verse. بل يقول, well, he should say, أنسيتها, I have been made to forget. أو أسقطتها. فقد ثبت في الصحيح عن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يقولن أحدكم نسيت آية كذا وكذا بل هو نسي. In the hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud رضي الله عنه, he said, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, one of you should not say, I have forgotten the verse so and so. Rather, you should say, I have been made to forget it. The etiquette of saying, if you forget a verse, the etiquette of saying it is that I have been made to forget it, not saying that I have forgotten it. وفي رواية في الصحيح, in the narration in Sahihain, Aidan, he said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, بِئْسَ مَا لِأَحَدِكُمْ أَنْ يَقُولَ نَسِيتُكَ آيَةَ كَذَا وَكَيْتْ بَلْ هُوَ نُسِيَ. He said, it's ugly, the affair of the one who says that I have forgotten the verse so and so, but rather he should say, I have been made to forget. وَثَبَتَ فِي صَحِيحَيْن, is also reported in authentic hadith that from Aisha رضي الله عنها, that the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, سَمِعَ رَجُلٌ, he heard a man reciting, فَقَالَ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ لَقَدَ لقد أذكرني آية كنت أسقطتها وفي رواية صحيح كنت أنسيتها. Okay, the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, he heard a man reciting the Quran, and then he was reminded by another person a verse that he had been made to forget. So he said, may Allah have mercy upon that man, he had made me remember a verse that I had been made to forget. The Prophet عليه الصلاة said that when the man recited the verse and the Prophet عليه الصلاة heard it, he said, this man, he reminded me of verse that I had been made to forget. Okay. وَأَمَّا مَا رَوَاهُ بِنْ أَبِي دَاوُودَ عَنْ أَبِي عَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنَ السُّلَمِ التَّابِعِ الْجَلِيلِ أَنَّهُ قَالَ لَا تَقُلْ أَسْقَطْتُ آيَةَ كَذَا بَلْ قُلْ أَغْفَلْتُ فَهُوَ خِلَافُ مَا ثَبَتَ فِي الصَّحِيحِ وَالْإِعْتِمَادُ عَلَى الْحَدِيثِ هُوَ جَوَازُ أَسْقَطُ وَعَدَمُ كِرَاهَتِهِ فَذَلِكَ. نعم. There's a narration narrated from Abu Abd al-Rahman al-Sulami, the great Tabi al-Jalil. He said that, لا تقول, do not say, أسقطتُ آية كذا, that I have been made to forget this verse so and so. أسقطتُ means that I have lost it, يعني, I've lost it from my mind. It's, I have gone blank, يعني. He says that him saying that you're not allowed to say that is خلاف of what's in the hadith. It goes against what's in the hadith, and you can say that. It's allowed to say that. It's not disliked to say that. Now, so that is the last section that we're going to conclude with today, inshallah ta'ala. So we have mentioned some of the general etiquettes today to do with the Quran, okay? And we started off, first of all, the rights of the Quran that we must observe. And then we spoke about venerating the Quran and not distorting the Quran, and distortion of the Quran is disbelief. And also we spoke about the rulings of the tafsir of the Quran, who is the person who's qualified to do the tafsir of the Quran. And also we spoke about that it's haram to debate regarding the Quran without any knowledge or any right, or to doubt the Quran. And also we spoke about the etiquettes of asking about something that is tawqifi in the Quran. And also we mentioned that it's like to say that I forgot a verse that you say. I have been made to forget it. هذا والله عليه وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. والحمد لله رب العالمين. If you have any questions, then I'll take questions inshallah ta'ala. If you have questions, you can ask inshallah. طيب, some people when distorting verses of the Quran, such as Allah's names and attributes, they say that these are verses that are mutashabih, they are ambiguous. So it is their ijtihad to understand. The verses this way, such as Allah's hands means His power, and so what do we do in reply to this? طيب, first of all, when it comes to the names and attributes of Allah تبارك وتعالى, the Quran gives us the قاعدة. ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير. That nothing is like Allah تبارك وتعالى, and He is السميع البصير, the all-hearing and the all-seeing. Now, the قاعدة that أهل السنة والجماعة they apply to the names and attributes of Allah تبارك وتعالى is that we do not interpret them, we do not distort them, we do not say how, we do not give examples, we do not compare them, etc. We leave them as they are, right? And we say that this is befitting to Allah تبارك وتعالى, this attribute is befitting to Allah تبارك وتعالى, to His Majesty جل في علا. And these people who interpret it, obviously it's a misguided path that they have taken, and they have actually created more problems for themselves. Because why did they go there? They said, for instance, when we say yad, hand, when Allah says He has a hand in the Quran, or Allah says that Allah mentions we affirm for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala a shin, we affirm for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala a foot, we affirm for Allah azza wa jal, all these things, right? So they say that these things they make Allah similar to the creation, right, to the human beings, but and then they try to, you know, interpret it to mean something else, so that it's far, Allah's far away from the creation, and there's nothing, Allah's not like the creation, but they fall into a bigger problem. They fall into a bigger problem, and it doesn't make sense, and all of that is wrong. All of that is wrong, and it's a misguided path. We do not take that path. The Quran is nothing ambiguous. There's nothing ambiguous. The English language is very poor. There's not a correct word for mutashabih, right? It's not ambiguous. It means that one can understand it to mean something else. It can have more than one meaning. One may understand it as something else, but the qa'idah, the ruling in the Quran is that the verses that may have more than one meaning that can be understood another way, we refer them back to the verses that can only have one meaning, which is muhkam. And I gave an example early on that when it said, inna nahnu anzalna dhikra, when Allah says, verily, we revealed the Quran. When Allah says we, one may say, okay, this may mean, oh, there's more than one God. But we refer back to the muhkam. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ. Can anyone understand قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ is more than one? No, we say Allah is one. Right? You refer back also to the muhkam. That's the way you understand them. And that's the way you do to understand these verses. How is the thing you... Okay. I think that's not to do our question. So does that mean, okay, alaykum salam wa rahmatullah, can you please explain? Qabli and ba'di to me once again, because my dad has been teaching me since, like forever, and I still don't get it. What do you mean by qabli and ba'di? I don't understand what you have meant by your question. Alaykum salam wa rahmatullah, can you give a general translation of an ayah of the Quran? You don't know precise word for word, but you know the general meaning. You can, you when it comes to translation of the Quran, there's a difference between translation and tafsir. When you mention translation of the Quran, obviously translation is not Quran. You're giving the general interpretation or the closest to the meaning. So what you should say is closest to the meaning. You should make a disclaimer. Now this is closer to the meaning of the ayah. This is the closest to that meaning and so on. Now, when a rak'ah is being missed or so. Okay, I still don't get what you mean when the rak'ah has been missed. Qabli and ba'di, what do you mean? Do you mean in the salah that I haven't understood? Do you mean when you're making it up after the rak'ah as you missed, how you make it up? I can tell you that, but I'm not too sure what the question means. Some people say that Imam Nawawi made ta'wil of some of the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and they say he was Ash'ari. So what do we say to this? Imam Nawawi, rahimahullah, was not an Ash'ari. He was Imam Ahl Sunnah al-Jama'ah. His teachers were Ash'aris. But the books that Imam Nawawi, he authored, they indicate he starts with what he believed. It was contrary to what an Ash'ari believes. And he's an Imam of Ahl Sunnah al-Jama'ah. And the Ash'aris, they claim him because he had no doubt he did have Ash'ari influences because of his teachers who were Ash'aris. But he did not, he was not an Ash'ari in belief. And that is affirmed by what he's actually written in his own hands. His own works, they prove that. Na'am, hadha wallahu a'lam. When say I was made to forget certain ayahs, referring back to Allah, like Allah made me forget. La la la. You're made to forget the Quran either because of your sins, or you're made to forget it either by shaitan or other factors. Now, okay, if you're referring to the salah, if you miss the rak'ah, how you make it up? What you do is, if you come late to the prayer and you join the prayer, okay, whilst the imam, if I've understood correctly, that you have joined the prayer and the imam, he is on the second rak'ah. Okay, and you've made it for the second rak'ah, you've missed one rak'ah. So that second rak'ah that you have joined the imam, you consider it your first rak'ah. Okay, so let's say now you've made it for the third rak'ah of the salah. You've made it for the third rak'ah with the imam. That means you have missed two rak'ahs, right? In a four rak'ah salah, you've made it to only two rak'ahs. So that third rak'ah that you have joined the imam, you consider it your first. So normally in a four rak'ah salah, the first, even if you sat, okay, your first, okay, they said good deeds are better done. Okay, that's another question. Okay, so you consider that third rak'ah your first rak'ah. And then that fourth rak'ah of the salah, you consider your second rak'ah. So then you have two rak'ahs that are left to be done. You do one, okay, without tashahud, the last one, at-tahiyyat. Okay, what about if I joined, okay, the salah in the second rak'ah? Or if I joined in a three rak'ah maghrib, and I've joined in the second rak'ah, that means I've missed one rak'ah. What about if I joined in the third rak'ah, I missed two rak'ahs? How do I make them up? I consider the last rak'ah that I'm praying with the imam my first rak'ah. And then the next two rak'ahs that I need to make up, I consider the last two rak'ahs of Maghrib. So last two rak'ahs of Maghrib, how do you pray them? You've prayed them both with at-tahiyyat, tashahud, you're sitting. So that salah, you would have prayed three tashahuds. One with the imam and two by yourself. Like that. I hope that makes sense, inshallah ta'ala. They said good deeds are better done privately than shown off. But what if, while others do unnecessary toxic challenges, you do a TikTok challenge of you reciting the Quran or doing all the Islamic deeds? These challenges that are done with the Quran and all this stuff, this is not from the Sunnah, right? These matters, you know, you shouldn't do it like this. There's not a way that you encourage people to do good. There's other ways to encourage people to do good, but these ways I would refrain from engaging in it. Wallahu a'lam. Alaykum as-salam. And also the matter of people, you know, showing off, etc., could be involved in these matters, which is a matter that you should be far away from. Alaykum as-salam. Can you favorize an ayah or surah? And second question, I have heard people saying I dislike an ayah because it's hard, or surah. Are they disbelieving Allah? Tayyib. Are you allowed to have a favorite ayah or surah in the Quran? You're allowed to have a favorite ayah or surah in the Quran. There's no problem with that. That's natural. Something the human being can't control. The second thing is that when people who say I dislike an ayah or because it's hard, etc., or surah, are they disbelieving? No, they're not. The thing is, they shouldn't say that. It's wrong to say I dislike an ayah. You can say I find the ayah difficult, but to say I dislike an ayah, that's wrong. Or I dislike a surah, that's wrong. But if the person, when they're saying this, I assume they don't mean they dislike the ayah, they just mean it's hard. And that's what's meant by, we tell them that they'll be sinful for saying that, but they're not disbelieving. Allahu a'lam. Alaykum as-salam. These sessions, they start at 7, they end hopefully by 8, normally. 7 to 8. Now, طيب. I think that was the final question. And if that's the case, inshallah ta'ala, we'll conclude there. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت استغفرك وأتوب إليك شكرا. I'll see you guys inshallah next week. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.